chant Om 3 times. गुरु ब्रह्मा गुरुर्विष्णु गुरुर्देवो महेश्वरः गुरुर्साक्षात् परब्रह्म तस्मै श्री गुरवे नमः। गुरवे सर्वलोकानां विषये भवरोगिणः निधये सर्वविद्यानां दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। ॐ नमः प्रणवार्थाय शुद्धज्ञानैकमूर्तये निर्मलाय प्रशान्ताय दक्षिणामूर्तये नमः। हरि ओम तत्सत्। नहि ज्ञानेन सदृशं पवित्रम् इह विद्यते तत्स्वयं योगसंसिद्धिं कालेनात्मानि विन्दति। You are born alone and they leave this planet alone. And in between this birth and death, between coming into this planet and going out of this planet, also you are alone. No matter what you think otherwise. The spiritual path is the path of an individual, it's not path of a crowd. You may start, you may live in a crowd, but where you reach, when you reach, it all depends upon you. It's like you may all start the marathon at the same time. Some may reach, some may not reach, some may drop off in the beginning itself. And the growth happens only at the individual level. And what propels that growth is your commitment. When you came into this planet, you had nothing. You had nothing which you could call yours. And you didn't want anything either. All you needed was something for your survival and for your physical comfort. But you were still very happy. You didn't have big desires, you didn't want to have this, have that. But you are not unhappy also. But as you grow up, you slowly start putting conditions to yourself that I need this to be happy, I need that to be happy. And you didn't even bother about any company when you were born. You didn't even bother whether you had friends or no friends, whether somebody was around you or not around you. But then slowly you start developing those attachments as well. I want this person, I want that person. And by the time you leave the planet, you are utterly lonely. You are so scared to leave everybody and go. So this is a movement of from being alone to becoming lonely, the normal life. Being alone is finding yourself. Feeling lonely is missing the other. Are you getting? You need to reverse this journey. You need to see that all you need, you have. And because we miss the other, because we start feeling more and more lonely, that's only because we start moving away from ourselves. When you are born, you are with yourself. The baby looks at its own fingers and is happy. It puts its own toe into its mouth and it is happy. It doesn't need anything at all. And that we need to go back. And because we look around and see, oh, that person is having this, so that's why I think they are happy, or this person is having this. So when you set these preconditions to be happy, what is happening? You are losing your individuality. So Krishna says, Swadharmo nidanam shreya paradharmo bhayavaha. Be aware of the crowd mentality. It is better to start exploring life on your own, even die imperfectly. Even if you don't achieve what you have to achieve, and if you don't do it perfectly, it is better to die than following a perfectly laid out plan of somebody else. Why do we find so much comfort in following the crowd? Because you don't have to use your intelligence. You don't have to be aware. If you know this is the route to go to your office, you have to go twice or thrice and that's it. Then you won't even think about it. Sometimes you don't even know when you sat in the car, when you got out of the car. So that is very predictable. And it fits within your comfort zone. You don't have to put any effort to go from here to there. And you think, oh, if everything in life was like this, then that's brilliant. But the self, the Purusha, is very dynamic. You cannot predict how it wants, how it behaves. And if you want to attain to yourself, you need to be comfortable with the uncertainty in life. When you feel that uncertainty is your certainty is your comfort zone, then you stop being open to life. You become very closed to life. And anything that pushes you a little out of your comfort zone, you become very uncomfortable. Do you see? You may go from here to Europe for a holiday. Even there you are looking very Saravana Bhavan. Even there you want your idli. They say there is a nice pasta restaurant here. Oh, pasta. Where is idli? One day you don't find your coffee or idli. Who wants Europe? The Eiffel Tower is just a rusted building. Let me go back. It will shake you. You see, you become very closed when you stop appreciating life in its all dimensions. And you think that is the only way to be happy, that's the only way to be comfortable. Oh, that is my comfort food. Do you see? This is once again putting convenience about commitment. So, Swadharmo Nidanam Shreya Paradharmo Bhayavaha. There is no purpose to life. If anybody says this is what is your purpose in life, then they don't know. There is absolutely no purpose to life. So, if you got a goal in your life, drop it. Okay?
I'll tell my boss.
If there is only a purpose to life, the only purpose is to explore and live life itself. Most of us don't live life. You are only moving from one target to another target. So leave, ask what is this all about, question whatever you are going through, and then seek what is the alternative. Swadharmo nidhanam shreya. You may fail, you may drop out, people may call you are abnormal, that's fine, but you are exploring life, you are not living a dead life. You know, you write to give, when you wake up a day on the morning, you write down all that you do from when you wake up till you go to sleep. You repeat the exercise after 6 months, there won't be any change, I tell you. You'll sleep on the same side of the bed, turn to the same side and get up, go to the same bathroom first, and go to the same kitchen, pick up the same cup. So where is life there? There is no aliveness, it is all dead, you are like a robo. But you feel comfortable with it. One day a maid or somebody comes and cleans the house, then you feel very upset. My chair was here, my table was here, my cup was here. Where is it? Where is it? So awareness is the only way to grow. And awareness is the one which will make you comfortable with the uncertainty. And the moment you stop exploring life, then you are dead already. Because there is no enthusiasm to do anything new, to try anything new. As a child, everything was enthusiastic for you, everything was interesting. But as an adult, you have fixed things. Only if this is there, then holiday is good. Only if these people are coming with me, then holiday is good. So, swadharma nidhanam shreya paradharmo bhayavah. Walk in the path where you are afraid to walk. Where you feel, what will happen to me? That is where you will drop your identity, you'll drop your ego. Otherwise, you keep on just following the crowd. Following the crowd. And then you will never discover yourself. Now, if you travel in UK, so there are these high mountains, the green mountains are there. So you keep traveling on the highway from one end of England to other end, or to Scotland or somewhere, you will see all the sheeps. The sheeps are there sitting and eating. After a week, you are returning back in the same road and you see they are still sitting there and eating. So cows or sheep, they don't get bored. They just go, get up in the morning, sit there, eat all day, sleep, that's it. The intelligence in you has to be awakened. And then life opens up. So be aware of the crowd mentality, because that is not your identity. And we have somehow made it our identity. And we tend to be comfortable with doing what everybody is doing. The moment you try to do something on your own, either somebody will label you as abnormal, or you yourself think, oh, how can I do this? Somebody will think something else. So explore life, so what people have their opinions. And look at all these people who are brought innovation into our life. They did not follow the crowd. They questioned the present, they questioned the routine. Steve Jobs, if you look at him, if he didn't question the routine, we wouldn't have an iPhone with us today. People would have still been carrying 10 things with them wherever they go. Isn't it? Every enlightened person has questioned the current. Buddha questioned things. Gurudev is doing it. Everybody is. They are coming out of their comfort zone and asking why we should do it this way, why not this. And then when they do that, what happens? The entire civilization takes another turn and moves. So you become the change rather than you following the crowd. And that's when life will open up to you. Okay? So, context-wise, where were we? We were in the position where Arjuna first says, I won't fight. Because it is not right to fight. And Krishna says, no, it is proper to fight. You can't escape from what you have to do. You are a kshatriya, your dharma is to uphold the righteousness. So you have to fight. and only by doing that you will reach where you have to reach. But then now you are confused. If you fight with this mentality, then you won't be able to give your 100%. So I will need to clarify a few things to you. The first thing he says is, if you have to understand whatever I am going to say, first you need some level of energy in you. You need to have your prana a bit high. So first you become a yogi. So tells how a yogi is. And says how the main source where we drain our prana is by seeking pleasure and by worrying. So when you put a full stop to it, when you are able to withdraw from the pleasure world, you are able to sustain a lot of prana. When you sustain this prana, you are able to have two things happen. One, what happens? You become a sthita prajna. Your awareness gets established. Your focus is unwavering. Two, you attain samadhi. Your intellect becomes equanimous. When both these things happen, you are able to perceive the truth. So first thing is develop the discipline. Become disciplined in your life. Until you become disciplined, then you won't be able to progress. So what is discipline? Putting commitment over convenience is your discipline. Whenever you have a choice, see that you hold on to commitment rather than to convenience. Okay, now you have become a yogi or more disciplined. Now what to do? There are two ways you can do. One is the path of action, other is the path of knowledge. But he says, I will tell you first, you do the path of action. And then he talks about how the prakriti, which is the name and form aspect of creation, which is limited by the five elements, is driven by the three gunas. And human beings mainly rajas driven, so they are action oriented. So if you don't give a direction to your rajas, the rajas will emerge as a distortion. The main distortions are lust and anger. When lust and anger overcome you, you will become deluded. Your intellect is not stable once you are in their grip. So you need to treat them as enemies. Don't support them when they come. Don't take them as your guests. Treat them as your enemies. When the guests come, what do? You open the door, you welcome them, you hug them, take them inside. When the enemies come, you close the door. So he says, treat them as your enemies. Paripanthinav, tauhi asya paripanthinav. Remember, they are indeed your enemies. No doubt about it. So when that happens, he says, keep them away. So now Arjuna asks, Krishna, I'm a bit confused now. You told me knowledge is better than action. And now you are asking me to act. And you are telling me, I am Rajasic, I have to act. And you also told knowledge leads to liberation. Action only leads to prosperity maximum. It does not lead you to liberation. Then why shouldn't I follow knowledge and become liberated than follow action? He's a smart cookie. So he's asking, he's finding another reason why not to fight. You only told me this. Now I want to do the best thing. Why do I want to take the second best thing? So Krishna says, yes, what you're saying is right. You heard it correctly. No action will lead you to liberation. But dropping actions will also not lead you to liberation. Not doing anything will also not lead you to liberation. So in that way, it is better you do some action. Why should you do action? He says there are two reasons. One, because by nature, human beings are rajasic. So they are more comfortable acting than not acting. So knowing you, I think it is better you act. So there are basically, you can say there are two types of people. Roughly you can say there are extroverts and introverts. Extroverted people are what? They want to be with people. They want to be in the world. They like company. They like gatherings. For them, the path of action is better. And there are people who like to be with themselves. These are not introverted, these are not withdrawn people as we think. These are people who are more comfortable with themselves, who don't miss company that very much, who are more focused on themselves. For them, the path of knowledge is better. But having known you, I think for you, action will suit you better. So he's just saying, not just for Arjuna, for most of the humanity. Most humanity likes to be with people, likes to go out, likes to interact. So for you, he says, action is better. He says, what is the source of action? He says, annat bhavanti bhutani, parjanyat anna sambhavaha, yajnat bhavati parjanyo, yajnat karma samudbhava. See, you are not just alone in this creation. The living beings survive on food. The food survives on rain. The source of rain is yajna. The source of yajna is rightful action. Rightful action is prescribed in the Vedas. Vedas come from me. So when you engage in yajna, you are actually engaging in me. So you need to engage in yajnas. That is the right action for you to do. And if you don't do that action, then what happens? You are running away from that particular responsibility of yours in the world. The circle of life will not be completed when you don't do your bit. When you don't do your yajna, the rains won't happen, there won't be food. When the food is not there, other beings will all suffer. So this whole balance in the ecosystem will be disturbed. So you have to act. So two reasons. One, because your rajas dominated and it is natural for you to act. Two, because it is your responsibility. You can't run away from it. It is part of action. What you have to do. Then he says, what are the type of action? He says, there are three main types of action. So you call it akarma, sukarma and karma. Says the most superior action is akarma. Means what? Non-action. Complete withdrawing from the doership of things. Seeing that everything is happening on its own. See, the earth is moving on its own. The stars are shining on their own. The sun is glowing on its own. What are you doing to make it happen? The air is blowing. Temperature changes on its own. The seasons come and go on their own. Okay, everything is up. Okay, now come to your own self. The breath is going in and out on its own. The digestion is happening on its own. The heart is beating on its own. What are you controlling? And now there is this delusion in our mind that I want to control. What is that you want to control in life? All the important things are anyway happening on their own. It is good they are happening on their own, isn't it? If you had to control your heartbeat, that is it. If you have to control your breathing, you can never sleep. Oh my God, if you sleep, your breathing will stop. Because who is controlling it? Do you see this? So the wise are aware that actually there is nothing in my control. Life is happening on its own. I am just a witness to everything that is happening. And when you stay in this awareness of being a witness, then that is akarma. You are brushing your teeth. And then you see, oh, I am brushing my teeth. You are seeing the person brushing the teeth. You are angry. You are seeing the person who is angry and shouting. You feel hunger. Then you see, oh, somebody else is hungry. So when you are able to create a gap between you and yourself, all your actions become non-actions. Because you see, oh, somebody else is doing. And then what happens between you and the other, there is pure awareness. And in that pure awareness, it's very difficult to make mistakes. When you shout in anger, you're lost yourself. You don't know what you are saying. That's why you shout and then you realize, why did I say this? because the awareness was not there. You like something, you want to eat, and then you overeat. After that, when your body says, you think, oh, I should not have eaten. The awareness had gone away, or you just pushed it aside. So in the Upanishads, there is this picture of two birds sitting on a branch. One bird is eating a fruit, the other bird is just looking at it. You must have seen this picture. So this is the Purusha looking at the Prakriti. Is you looking at yourself and witnessing what you are doing. And when you get slowly established in this witness consciousness, all your actions are non-actions. What do non-actions? Non-actions do not generate any karma, because there is no doership there. You see it as a happening rather than you doing. And when that awareness is there, one, you stop all sorts of nonsense you are doing anyway. And you realize the absurdity of the most of the things you are doing, and you slowly withdraw from them. So you will only be doing things which are really essential and spontaneous at that point in time. In one sense, being a witness is the highest responsibility you can take in life. You are acting very, very responsibly. You come with some prarabdha, you are burning it anyway. And through your awareness, you are burning the seeds of your sanchita karma. So the agami is not happening. So only thing that has happened, the prarabdha has to burn out. And when the prarabdha is burning, you go through some unpleasant sensations, you think, oh, some prarabdha is burning, that awareness is also in there. So even that will not accumulate. So if you are in akarma, you get liberated very easily. So in the Brahma Sutras, Adi Shankara says, akarmanyeva moksham. That's the first line he says. Only through non-action you can be liberated. Action will only lead you to heaven or hell. You may get more pleasure, you may get more prosperity, or you may get more discomfort, but you will never be free. Freedom only comes when you start dropping your doership. And this is how you do. This is the superior type of action, karma. Then karma. Karma is the actual karma. Most of us, when you think karma, we think bad karma. So that is karma. Karma is any action which you do expecting a result or wanting to produce a result is karma. Just think all that you do in your day. Any action you do wanting to produce a result is karma, because it acts as a seed for future karma. If this result is produced, you behave in way. If the result is not produced, your action will be different. So it propels more action. Are you getting what I am saying? All actions which you do out of ignorance, because when you think about producing a result, actually what you are saying, I think I am in control of this. You are trying to control a situation in a particular way. So this is karma, or kukarma you can say, where you already have a load of sanchita which is not yet sprouted. You are going through prarabdha and you are putting even more seeds of action. So the agami will become even bigger. So you got no escape. Your baggage keeps on increasing. And then what happens? And then nature looks at you and says, see, this lifetime is not enough for you. So we'll keep something for the next time. So you come back again. And this continues again and again. You never learn, you keep on accumulating. Already you got a loan, you keep on taking loans again. So you end up your whole life just paying interest, the principal stays there. So this is kukarma, or karma, what we generally call, is getting engaged in actions, wanting to have an agenda. That is why charity is so important, where you go and help out people without expecting anything from them. Sometimes you want to help people whom you not even know about them. Isn't it? That is one way of getting rid of the bad karma. And then there is the middle path, the middling. It is neither the most superior action nor the inferior action. It is somewhere which you can manage, the humanity can manage. And this is called sukarma or yajna. Says, if there is any action you want to engage in yajna. That is the only action worth engaging in. And he says, yagya, dana and tapa, these are the three things if you want to direct your rajas, direct them in these three things. Put your rajas into action by following these principles, yagya, dana and tapa. Now, dana and tapa are more of an attitude rather than action. Dana is being generous, tapa is forbearing, but yagya is the actual action. So, what is yagya? So we learnt on the other session that this gross world is under the control of the subtle elements. So when you do Rudra Puja, you chant, isn't it? Prajanane Brahma Tishtatu Padayur Vishnu Tishtatu. You say what? Oh, my movement is controlled by Vishnu. My creativity is by Brahma. My intellect is by Saraswati. My hearing is from Ashwini Devatas. You know? The fire controls my eyesight. My awareness comes from Rudra. My intelligence comes from Aditya. My ability not to make mistakes comes from Vamadeva. So you are already attributed that to everybody. You see, even the basic functions you do, somebody else is controlling it. These are called the subtle elements in the society, in the creation. So the subtle elements control the gross world. But the subtle elements or the subtle energies, they don't have a physical body. So they don't need pleasure. See, because you have got a physical body, you seek pleasure. Are you noticing this? When you sleep, you don't have a physical body sensation. So you don't seek pleasure when you sleep. When you are awake, you think you have got a body, so the body seeks pleasure. The subtle deities, they don't have a body, so they don't seek the pleasure the way you do. But what they seek gratitude, they seek generosity, they seek devotion, they seek sincerity, they seek appreciation. And they have the ability to bless you with all the prosperity you are seeking. You want some money, you want somebody to be married, you want somebody to be educated, you want somebody to become healthy. Because all this we already said, health somebody manages. Finance somebody manages. You see? So yagya is a process of exchange. You give the subtle world what it wants and you get from it what you want. So this is yagya, is the process of exchange. And in yagya you've got three types. You've called jnana yagya, dhyana yagya and dravya yagya. Dhyana yagya is meditation. When you meditate, what happens? You become one with the subtle forces. So they feel the oneness with you. And then what happens? Their mind becomes your mind. So whatever you think also goes in them. And because the minds overlap, it is easily you can get what you want. Then you become intuitive. Your sankalpas will start manifesting because your mind is merged with the subtle mind. Now Gurudev calls this the small mind and the big mind. So when you meditate, what happens? Your small mind merges with the big mind. No, sometimes in satsang it happens. If you are now you hear we don't do satsang that regularly, but you have been in places before, so you are sitting in satsang, you are deep into it, suddenly you think, next we should sing this song, suddenly somebody starts singing that song. Has it happened? Yeah? What is happening? The small minds have all merged with one mind. So this is exactly what happens when you meditate. What happens? Your individual small notions and impressions will dissolve and the big mind will take over. And when that takes over, whatever the desire in your mind is there, that becomes the desire of the devata. And they manifest. And for them, these are little things. All what do you want in life? You all want something in this material world, isn't it? That is very easy for them to give. It's like, what does your child want from you? Some chocolate, some toy, some free time. That you can easily give, isn't it? As long as you are happy, you can easily give it. That's exactly how it works. For them, this is nothing for me, so what? He is asking for a couple of extra chocolates, let them have. Your child asks for biscuits, you ask for gold biscuits, that's all. Just a couple of biscuits, so let him have it. There is plenty anyway. So this is dhyana yagya, that's why it's called the most superior action. Because you then start influencing the subtle world by your meditation. So when you meditate, all the angels, they feel happy. All your ancestors, they feel happy. A part of your meditation, if you feel really go deep, the part of the merit will go to them. If they left the body feeling uncomfortable, discontented, they will feel a bit more, what do they call? Santwan. Sukoon, they say in Hindi. They will feel, sort of a thing. So if you are initially learning meditation or doing your Kriya and staying some time, sometimes you feel that your meditation is not, you don't feel much, know that somebody is sucking away your merits because they need it more than you. So this is Dhyana Yajna. Next is Jnana Yajna, which what we are doing. We are actually realizing the higher self. This is a spiritual gossip. We are all interested, but we are also listening. And then you see, wow, oh, this is how it is. Oh, this is how it is. So what happens? That will bring about a transformation in you. When you listen to it again and again and again, you say, oh yes, next time when you are doing something, you say, see, last time what was the homework we gave it to you? Observe what guna is dominating. Is it sattva which is dominating you right now? Is it tamas which is rajas? If you're feeling sleepy and tired and oh, rajas is coming up. What I need to do? I need to be a bit more aggressive. I need to stand up. I need to shake my hands. If you're feeling very energetic, very restless, it's, oh, rajas is dominating now. I feel very hungry. I feel like eating. And if you feel, oh, I'm feeling so light and happy, then oh, sattva is coming up. I need to just hold on to this. So this comes only through Jnana Yajna, is through awareness. Oh, this is what is happening, this is what is happening, this is what is happening. If you see the whole Gita as that person talking to this person, then nothing will happen in your life. You should say, Bhagavan is speaking to me. I have got the same problems as Arjuna has. I'm going through the same sort of anguish. Oh, he's telling something to me. And that is the beauty of Gita, in that wherever you are in your life, at some point you can relate to it. It's not like Ashtavakra Gita or a Yoga Vasishta where you don't even understand what is being told. If you read Yoga Vasishta, you get so thoroughly confused. In Ashtavakra Gita, you feel sleepy because the knowledge becomes so heavy after a while, you just say, okay, this is enough for me for today. But Gita is so light, at the same time so deep. It has the same knowledge in the other ones. But then Krishna is not addressing only Arjuna, is addressing the whole of humanity and saying, look, 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 this is where you get stuck, isn't it? I know. Now I'm giving you the solution. Now look into it. This is Jnana Yajna. Just bringing up a bit of awareness in just what you do. If you are doing a lot of stupid things, become aware of the absurdity of many things. And then you see, oh, okay. When people say, don't have time, I don't have time. Just write down all that you do in your time and you will see a lot of things can be eliminated from your life and you will have a lot of time. Then you will say, what should I do? So this is Jnana Yajna. Then comes the Dravya Yajna. See, to all these things, you again need a particular level of energy. If you don't have a particular level of energy, you cannot meditate. To meditate, you should have a little bit of sattva in you. And that sattva should trigger bigger sattva. If the sattva is very minimal in your life and your rajas is dominating, you sit, only thoughts come. You are awake, nothing is happening. The moment you sit for meditation, it hurts here. What is happening? Your energy has gone down and your rajas is trying to find a way to come out. And then it's saying, hey, why are you wasting time? Get up, go switch on the TV, go have a shower, go to open the cell phone. And suddenly at the same time you get a ting message. Oh, look, somebody is telling something to you. So that is rajas coming up. So when we also said the one thing you can control in your life is the amount of rajas and tamas. That is the only thing where you have a control. How? Food and company. If you attend to your food and company, then you can control the amount of rajas and tamas in your system. So if you are not got this awareness, and if you don't do it, even if you got this awareness, your prana will be a default level of how the life takes you around, how the mind takes you around. And then what happens? You can't do anything. So I can't present to knowledge. Come to knowledge session, you know, I got this to do, that to do, that to do. Sit in meditation, oh, nothing happens to me, I just sit and waste my time. If you are one of those, then he says, well, at least do some dravya yagya. You sit, somebody will chant some mantras, you do something. You do some swaha, swaha. At least there, instead of chanting gold biscuit, you say Narayana. So say something different, so something will come out. So dravya yagna is for those who can't do any of the higher yagyas. But it also adds a variety to your life. It is good to have that also. Once in a while, it's good to eat some bad food also. So you will realize what's the value of good food. So in the same way, everything has its place. So get engaged. So if you say, oh, I'm bored of meditation, go and do some rituals, do some chanting, go do some reading, share some knowledge. So all these three are important. So yagya is, all this is a process of exchange. Even in dravya yagya, what you do? You are offering, say for example, the energy called Shiva, for that you are offering the bilvam, because that dravya is favorite for that. You give tulsi, or you give lemon, or you give grass. These are all parts of dravya yagya. You create a kalash and put water. So these are dravya yagyas where you use the elements, and through the elements, there are certain parts of elements which certain deities like it. You give it to them. Look, I'm giving it to you. I don't get bilvam here, I brought it from India, I've given it to you. So for my effort, give me this. That is the exchange you are doing. So it is basically an exchange process. So I'm doing this for you, you do this for. You're just trying to please. So all your shlokas, chanting, they're all stutis, isn't it? You're praising. You know, if somebody praises you with 1,000 names, won't you be happy? Even 5 names is enough. Come on. Why are you standing outside? Come inside. What do you want? Shall I make some pakodas for you? So when you chant 1,000 names, the God is so happy. What do you want? You want some biscuits? Take it. That's all. No worries. So that is the principle, is what you exchange. You make the deities happy, and they are happy through stuti. See, the world is under the adhina of devas, and devas are under adhina of mantras, they say. That's why, you know, there is very beautiful world. When somebody passes away, they say daivadina. They have gone from your control to the control of the elements, to the control of deities, they say. This is yagya. And in yagya, there are 3 parts. It's called deva puja, sangati karana, and dana. Deva puja is honoring these subtle elements. First, recognizing them. Most people don't even recognize that the world is run by something subtle. So recognize them. See, when somebody is coming and sitting in your house, you don't even recognize them, how will they feel? So most of the world runs like that. Their digestion somebody is doing, their heart somebody is making to beat, everything somebody is controlling, but you don't even recognize them. You don't even see that they are there in the first place. So they are so upset. So they give you some trials here and there. Come on. But when you recognize them, when you honor them, that's when you do your puja, your dravya puja, what do? You do the avahanam. You call them. I know you are here. Please come and sit in this seat. I'm giving you this ratna simhasanam. I'm giving water to wash your feet, wash your hand. I'm putting all these nice things. I'm using the fan. It's very hot here. I'm putting the AC for you. You do all those things. What you are doing, you're basically saying that I honor you. I know because of you, a lot of my things are happening, so I honor you. Please accept my gratitude. And when you say that, what they feel? They feel happy. They say, okay. See, if your child does not ask you anything on their birthday, and if it does its job properly, doing is going to school and everything, even without them asking, you will give them what they need. You, in fact, will give them more than what they ask. Isn't it? That is exactly how this works. When you show that recognition that, you know what, without you, where would I have been? that is good enough. Then we say, oh, this man is a bit more awake now. So let us make. So what happens when God says, what is it that distracts him from knowledge? Is this pleasure and prosperity. Letting him as much pleasure and prosperity he wants. Let him go through it also. Then he will see that I am bigger than that. That will only happen. This is called the life of grace. When you recognize the value of divinity, grace pours into your life. People look after you. Life looks after you. And then all you have to do is just recognize the divinity and stay with it. Are you getting what I'm saying? So this is Deva Puja. And every puja you do should take you from the gross to the subtle. This is very important. Sometimes you get so much stuck with the formalities of the puja. It should help you to transcend. Okay? You're not selling Tegu mantras and saying, bring the coconut here. Or telling another mantra, saying, what are you doing there? Put the AC on. That is, you're just doing a tick box exercise. Do you see? When somebody is talking to you, you say one word and then look at your phone again. And then, okay. So that means you are not honoring that person. Are you getting what I am saying? So the rituals have been constructed in a particular way so that without your effort you can transcend the physical and get into the subtle space. So that your sankalpas are fulfilled. That's why in every dravayagya you make a sankalpa to begin with. So at some point in time, you are able to transcend and merge with the mind of the devas, and so your sankalpa will get fulfilled. But if you get too much stuck with the actual doing of it, then what happens? You will never merge. You are always worried whether that guest is okay, whether you gave tea to him or you gave coffee to him, whether food is cooking okay. It's like, you know, going into the temple and thinking about your chapel. It's like that. So your attention is not where it should be. So just bring this to your awareness. You know, Dravya Yajna is also very good. But in that Yajna, the purpose is to move from Dravya to Jnana, to Jnana to Dhyana. That is where it has to take you, where the support system takes you. The mantras and pandits and all. The pandits, why do you take a pandit? He says, you don't know how to do, I know how to do it. I will do all the things. You just close your eyes and sit here. When I say Swaha, say Swaha. When I ask you to touch that. That's all. You don't worry about everything else. I will do everything else. Are you getting this? So next time I sit for a puja, have this awareness. This is how I should be in the puja. So, Deva Puja. Sangati Karana. It is very difficult to raise the energy when you are alone. The rajas can distract you so much. You are so conditioned in this world that it takes a lot of effort to break this condition. So get people together and do it together. When you do it together, what happens? The group energy rises. In that energy, your energy also comes up. For you to feel warm, what you should do? Get into a warm room. Then automatically you feel warm. Even the room is cold, if 50 people are sitting, in a few minutes the room will become warm. So he says, Sangati Karana, come together. When you come together, maybe in that group there is a person who is much more aware, whose energy is much higher. And you sit with them and their energy comes to you also. And the moment they get into the subtle space, it will become easy for you also because their energy is spreading, expanding. And in that energy field, you are also sitting there. It is happening. And this happens, isn't it? You do kriya at your home on your own and you come here with everybody. They are different, the quality is different. Yeah. And you go to the ashram and do your kriya, do your advanced course and you see it is completely different. So what is happening? When you go to places where people with high energy are there, then without your effort, you will get that energy. That's why it's important to be in satsang. To be in the company of the wise, in enlightened beings, because just by their presence they elevate you. Sangati Karana. And then Dana. This is another important thing. If you go to a yajna and take something out of it, but don't give anything, you are called a thief. You are stolen the yajna phala. You should always give something, even if it means a blessing. Don't ever go to a yagya and come back not giving anything. So dana is a very important aspect of every yagya. That's when you do a puja, you know, don't ask, call people, you also give them nice food to eat. That is your dana. You have come here, so I'm looking after you. So when you go, you also take something. So you don't go empty handed. So as a part of what you said, let it also go to the divine. So having this attitude of generosity, and in any yagya, so you come here, to you do your kriya every week, and then if you feel one day, okay, we need to do something to this place, then you should take responsibility. Because this is where I am getting so much out of it. Do you see? It is not, oh, somebody is doing so, I just have to go there, do my kriya and go. Somebody else do it. That means you are a thief. You are coming here stealing all the good things and going away, not giving anything. And do you remember this? Do you know this? A thief will never enjoy what he steals. Can never enjoy, because he will get caught. If a thief steals something and starts enjoying it, suddenly people will know, where did he get all this? A thief can never enjoy what he steals. So people who come to a yagya and go away thinking that they have taken something, not giving, will never enjoy the fruit of it. The karma of yagya phala will never touch them. Are you getting what I am saying? So it's very important to have an attitude of generosity. Instead of coming with that, what can I get? If you say, what can I give? What can I do? That is all you have to do. So every week you come here, everything is spread and ready for you. You should think, who does all this? One day I should also come and help out. That is dana. That is good enough. Some people do it anyway. I know that. What I am saying is, you don't have to open your bank account and give it to everybody else. That is also part of it. There are people who need that also. And another aspect of dana is what? Giving what you think is precious for you. Not giving what is useless for you. That is not dana. You are getting what is precious for you, but you are giving what is useless for you. That does not become a dana. What you really value, able to give a part of it. That is dana. So when these three components are satisfied, then you have done a yagya. Deva puja, honoring the space. Sangati karana, making sure the group is there. See, last week there were very few people. Maybe the timings was different, whatever. But at any week, have you checked with your friend or something? Are you coming this week or not? That means you are not contributing to the sangati karana. You are saying, I will come. If somebody comes or doesn't come, what can I do? If you have this attitude, you are not in sangati karana. You should ask, at least 2-3 people in this group whom you know very well, isn't it? Before you come, next time you say, are you coming, I'm going. If they say, no, I've got this, you say, oh, you should tell them. Oh, come on, that can be done afterwards. I'll come and help you with that. Why don't you come now with me? That is sangati karana. You are making sure, because if the group doesn't come, the energy doesn't build up. If the energy doesn't build up, then you are losing. So you say, you know what, come. This is sangati karana, making sure that everybody gets. And also that is also in some way generosity. You want them also to enjoy. You also them also to be good. You want everybody to benefit from it also. So yagya, dana, tapa, in yagya, deva puja, sangati karana. So dana comes in both places. So it is such, so important. Because as we were talking in the karma chapter on the other day, one of the ways to eliminate your bad karma is by accumulating good karma, and that you get through dana. So yagya is like a soap to wash away the bad karma. Are you getting this? So these are the three types of action. The superior action, which is akarma, the middle action, which is yagya, and the inferior action, which is just ordinary karma, ordinary action, where you just start accumulating more and more and more karma. Okay? So, now we know what the type of action. Then, what is the difference between the action of a wise person and the action of an ignorant person? We already covered a few points of it. The ignorant person goes with an attitude of, from this act, what I am going to get? The wise person says, from this action, how many people I'm going to help out? How much can I give? The wise person always thinks about everybody else when he does something. If I do this, will that harm that person? If I do this, how many people will get benefited? And he puts his focus on benefiting more people. He wants more people to get to this. See, if you prepare something, if you are very good at cooking something nice, and there is nobody to eat it, when you have to eat it, how will you feel? Do you see? You feel so much joy in sharing and giving it to everybody and seeing them enjoy it. That's the same thing with the wisdom also. When you have wisdom and you can't share, that is like suffocation. You feel like, why I can't share it with them? I want to see them also be happy. I want them also to be more relaxed. I want everybody to progress. That is the way wise acts. And the wise does not distract people from action. Even if the actions are imperfect, he knows that actions are a product of gunas and karmas. So let them, by action at least, they will get, in some way, it nullifies. So they don't distract people from actions. And the wise live knowledge. They live by example. So Krishna says, I need nothing from this world. And by doing action, by not doing any action, I won't lose anything in this world also. But still I act. Why? Because people will look at me and take me as an example. And when they take me as an example, if their intellect is not mature, they will only misunderstand me. They will misunderstand who we don't have to do anything. Akarma means do nothing. Not everything will come to me. So that Krishna has told. So he says, no, no, no. All the wise people. See, Buddha was so busy all his life. See how much Gurudev travels around. They don't have to do anything. This is another thing. If you are not going to get anything from this world, if you are not expecting anything from this world, you are not obliged to do anything to the world also. But the moment you say, I want this from the world, you are obliged. That is, your, then becomes your duty to give something back to the world. So the enlightened people, they don't need anything from the world. They are self-sufficient. But they do to stand as an example to everybody that, you see, even though I don't need anything, I'm doing this so that you also get inspired. And they inspire, isn't it? They have inspired so many people to come out of their comfort zone to do things. And that is the real action. What? Engaging in yajna without expecting any result from the yajna, without expecting anything to come back to them, that is the real yajna. And by doing it day in, day out, they are standing in front of you as a live example. Look, I am born like you. I will die like you. I eat food like you. I breathe air like you. But look, I can live life differently and you can also live. All you have to do is follow me. Hold my hand. I will take you. So this is how the action of a wise is different. What? They are established in akarma. They are non-doers. They are very busy, engaged in action, but not indulging in anything. They live by example and they live for everyone. This is the action of the wise. So whenever you are looking at any action, analyze, what is this action? Is it an action of wisdom or an action of ignorance? Good. And then at the end of all this, he says a very beautiful shloka, you know. That probably is the whole crux or essence of this whole chapter. What he says? Mayi sarvani karmani sanyasya dhyatma chetasa nirashir nirmamo bhutva yudhyasva vigata jvara. So if you forget all that we spoke today, if you remember this, that is good enough. He says, you didn't understand any of this, Arjuna, don't worry. Just offer everything to me. Your action and results, offer to me. Whatever you do, you say, Krishna Arpanamastu. It's up to you. This thought has come to me because of you. This action is propelled by me because of you. And the result is also yours. Na karta na bhokta. I'm not the doer, I'm not the sufferer. मयि सर्वाणि कर्माणि सन्यस्य अध्यात्म चेतस, जस्ट ऑफर एवरी एक्शन टू मी अध्यात्म चेतस, रेस्ट योर माइंड इन द पुरुष इन योर सेल्फ, निराशीर निर्ममो भूत्वा. निराशीर मीन्स वॉट? Dropping the expectations, dropping the desires. Oh, this should happen by what I did. I did something good, they should respect me, they should praise me. Nirashir. I'm not dependent on the world for anything. Nirmama. I'm not doing it. Bhutva. Yudhyasva vigata jvara. He's not saying just sit down, not saying, he says fight. Fight with all the valor in life. But fight thinking that I am not fighting, I don't want anything from this fight. Look, if you are fighting for something in your life with all your heart, you are so focused on the result. Do you see? I want this to happen, I'll fight for it. All the protests you see in the world, all the fights, all the marches, why? They have want a result. You see, so this is so beautiful. It does not say sit quiet in a corner. He says go and fight. But fight with an attitude of I am not fighting. I don't want anything from it also. All that I am doing is inspired by the Lord. It belongs to Him. Whatever happens is also His. Yudhyasva vigata jvara. So this is the most important word. Jvara is feverishness. When you want something, look how shaky you become. The more you want it, the more shaky you are, the more unstable you are. Isn't it?
Yes.
You have done an interview, you want to know the result. They have not called you yet. See how shaky you are. You're looking at your WhatsApp, looking at your phone. You can't sit in one place. That is jvara. When there is jvara, you are so totally attached to the result of action. He says, in that way you are not surrendering. So, mayi sarvani karmani sanyasya adhyatma chetasa nirashir nirmamo bhutva yudhyasva vigata chvara. Every word is so heavy in this shloka. Every little thing. He has covered it completely. He says you have to act, you can't escape. But when you act, leave everything to me. I am acting through you. And don't think you are doing, and don't be too much bothered about what's going to come out of it. But don't sit quiet. Put your 100% and act. And don't be feverish about it. Because anyway, you are neither acting, you are neither experiencing. It is only me. Nirashir nirmamo bhutva yudhyasva vigata jvara. See, yudhyasva is also important. You have to put 100%. The moment you see you are not bothered about the result, you don't put your 100%. Have you seen that? When the result does not matter, see, you are standing, somebody says, can we take a photograph of us? You are visiting somewhere. You don't bother, you just take a click and go. Isn't it? If you want to really get a good click, what you do? You are so 100% into it. If somebody has to take a photograph, you don't know who they are. You will just, okay, click. Is it okay? Go. They're putting all these different aspects together. You say, even when you are not expecting anything out of it, you put your 100% and do without feverishness. Yudhyasva vigata jvara. That much an effort. Okay? Jai Gurudev. Jai.